So I hope he talks about Boltzmann brains in this video, but if he doesn't, you can bet that's what we're going to be talking about, because I love this whole idea. And you know, simulation stuff is awesome, but I think this Boltzmann thing is even crazier. It's fun as hell to think about, so let's get into the video. You should come sign up for my newsletter that I send out every single day, The Daily Dance. Just breaks down all the latest science and world news from the previous 24 hours. And I send it off each day, and it's personal and fun, and it's completely free. You can sign up in the description. I'm also creating a post-quantum VPN, first of its kind, and that the alpha, which is going to be free, comes out really soon, so you should come sign up if you want to get notified for that as well. Is reality real? The simulation argument.
We humans are unable to experience the true nature of the universe unfiltered. Our senses and brains can only process a fraction of the world. So we have to use concepts and tools to learn about the true nature of reality. Technological progress not only widened our knowledge about the universe, it also made us aware of unsettling possibilities. In the future, it might become possible to simulate entire universes. But if this is an option, how can we know that it's not already happened? What if we are not creators, but creations? Is it possible that we are not real, and we don't even know it? If our current understanding of physics is correct, then it's impossible to simulate the whole universe with its trillions and trillions of things. But we don't actually need to anyway. We only need enough universe to fool the inhabitants of our simulation into thinking that they're real. Who needs billions of galaxies? We only need the space our subjects are allowed to explore.
The vast universe could just be a flat projection, and they would have no way to know.
It could be, but I think if it was, we'd be able to figure it out. We've figured out probably crazier things already. So, yes, it definitely could be though.
What about small things like cells or bacteria? We don't really need them. When you use a microscope, what you see could be instantly created. Same with atoms. The chair you're sitting on right now does not need to be simulated with quadrillions of atoms. We just need the outermost layer of it. It might be empty inside until you decide to break it open. Your body might feel like it's filled with bubbly things, but it might be empty until you open it. The minimum requirement for our simulation is only the consciousness of our virtual humans. Our subjects just need to think the simulation is real. Okay, so are we being simulated? Well, maybe, but there are a few conditions that need to be met. Obviously, we have no authority over this topic, so please take everything we say with a grain of salt. Based on a modified version of the original simulation argument by Nick Bostrom, we have five assumptions for you. If they're true, you, dear viewer, are living in a simulation. Assumption 1. It's possible to simulate consciousness. Nobody knows what consciousness is.
I think it's possible.
For the sake of argument, let's assume that you could generate consciousness by simulating a brain. Brains are pretty complex.
If you count every interaction between synapses as one operation, your brain runs at about 10 to the power of 17, or 100 million billion operations per second. Let's generously assume we need 10 to the power of 20 operations to simulate 1 second of human consciousness. But we don't want to simulate just one human, we want to simulate all of human history at once, so we can skip around. Let's say we want to simulate 200 billion humans with an average lifespan of 50 years. 1 year has 30 million seconds, times 50 years, times 200 billion humans, times 10 to the power of 20 operations.
So we need a computer able to handle a million, trillion, trillion, trillion operations per second. A computer like this is just impossible. Except, maybe it isn't.
So let me tell you about these Boltzmann brains. It's such a weird idea. The real problem is basically just the combination of, you know, infinite time, which is a real possibility. The universe might be infinite. And, you know, you're combining that with the probabilistic laws of quantum physics. You combine the two, you have Boltzmann brains and a big problem. So in the far future, there will you know, there'll be particles, you know, floating randomly around the universe, governed by quantum mechanics. And every now and then, you know, en route to eternity, they'll sometimes bang into each other, right? And, you know, some weird stuff will happen. And it won't happen, you know, very often, because they're mostly fairly isolated in the far future. But if you wait an infinitely long time, very strange things can happen. One of those weird things, right, is that these particles could smash into each other and create a human brain just out there in the void, floating around. And, you know, these brains, they can have a thought, and it gets even stranger. So now let's just think about that brain. Well, it's possible that it could have the exactly the same, you know, brain as you. The atoms are all arranged in the exact same way as your brain right now. And you guys might think, that doesn't sound very likely, right? What's the probability of that? Well, you know, when you're waiting an infinitely long time, the probability of that is essentially one. It's bound to happen. This Boltzmann brain stuff is pretty bothersome, because if you actually, you know, think about where do we come from? Like, where did your brain come from, right? A lot of us are going to think, you know, you're born, and you blah, blah, blah. You trace it all the way back, you know, to the very beginning of the universe, right? And that's a cool story, bro. But, you know, the number of brains that can come about in that sort of manner, right, is actually infinitesimal compared to, you know, the amount of brains that can form in the void if you're waiting for eternity, for an infinite amount of time. So if you ask yourself, you know, which one are you? One's very rare, like the one we talked about with the Big Bang, the one we think. Or, you know, you're one of those infinite brains floating in the void. And since there's so many more of those, you know, compared to the typical, you know, the one we think, well, then you're actually probably a brain floating in the void, you know, who's just imagined this story. Everything you think you know right now is all imagined in this Boltzmann brain. It's completely possible. It gets even weirder. You know, listen to this. So it kind of ends up being a pretty self-defeating conclusion, because the only reason we even, you know, anticipate this possibility is due to the laws of, you know, nature, the laws of physics and cosmology, and you just extrapolate, right? But if they're real, then our recollections of having learnt, you know, general relativity, quantum mechanics, that's also, you know, false. It's not real. And all the data that, you know, we thought supported, you know, quantum mechanics and general relativity, that's also just a particle configuration of my brain right now. So you see, it winds up defeating all logic. A lot of physicists that, you know, take this seriously, you know, we hope we're not one of these Boltzmann brains, but what they use it for is to basically, you know, calibrate theories, you know, so we can't arrive at this Boltzmann brain scenario. So it's useful, but I am saying it is possible that you're a Boltzmann brain. So this is all going to come back to the second law of thermodynamics, right? So let's explain a little bit of physics here so you can understand this. You know, it should really probably be called the second, like, tendency, you know, the most probable tendency of the universe, right? Because it's a probabilistic statement. It's basically just very likely that, you know, if you have a bunch of stuff, you know, it's going to evolve in a way that increases its entropy, right? But it doesn't always go like that. It can be temporarily violated. A good example is, like, you know, a 50-50 scenario, like a coin flip. You know, how many times out of 100 do you think you're going to get hit, right? Everyone knows it's roughly 50-50, right? But, you know, it is possible to get 100 hits in a row. It's very unlikely, but it is completely possible. And this is kind of how it is with the laws of physics in the universe. So just like the universe, you know, a move towards, you know, more complex configurations of things, a move towards order, low entropy, extremely unlikely, completely possible. So if you combine that with infinite time, what are you going to get? That's right, Boltzmann brains. Hopefully one day we can, you know, like, just get rid of this idea, and it doesn't end up being, you know, a possibility, and have some confidence back in physics, but we're not there yet. It really is still a possibility.
Assumption 2, technological progress will not stop anytime soon. If we assume that technological progress continues in a similar fashion as it has so far, then there might be galaxy-spanning civilizations with unlimited computer power at some point. Beings on a technology level so advanced that we could barely distinguish them from gods. A computer that can handle a million trillion 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 operations is serious business, but there are actually concepts for computers which could handle this. The Matryoshka brain is a theoretical megastructure made up of billions of parts orbiting a star feeding on its radiation. A computer of this scale would have enough power to simulate many thousands, if not millions, of humanities at the same time. Other technologies, like high-end future quantum computers, might lower the size drastically, so it might be possible to do this with a structure the size of a large city, or even smaller. But only if there's still someone around to build the computer. Assumption 3. Advanced civilizations don't destroy themselves. If there is a point at which all civilizations destroy themselves,
yeah, this one's not looking good.
This whole discussion ends here. Looking into space, you'd expect a universe filled with millions of alien civilizations, but we see nobody.
Not necessarily.
The reason for this might be great filters. Great filters are barriers.
We watched his video on the great filter, so you should go check that out.
Barriers life has to overcome, like nuclear war, asteroids, climate change, or a black hole generator. If life is inherently self-destructive, then there are no simulations.
We explain this
in more detail in our Fermi Paradox video. Assumption 4. Super-advanced civilizations want to run simulations. When we speak of post-human civilizations, we don't know what we're dealing with. To think we know what beings as powerful as gods want is pretty arrogant. Imagine the smartest ant on Earth living next to an amusement.
Don't you think if you had the power to create such simulations of like a realistic universe, why would you ever like sprawl out amongst the universe? Why wouldn't you then just create it in a computer, adjust the rules a little bit so it's, you know, a little bit more enjoyable or something? That seems more logical to me rather than trying to do something that's really hard, which is, you know, getting to other star systems. If you have that sort of power, it almost seems better to just hang around your planet, you know, make sure stuff's, you know, going to be fine for a long time, and then simulate all kinds of incredibly fun places, right?
Park. It's curious about what humans are up to, so you try to explain. Unfortunately, the ant just doesn't understand. The concept of roller coasters and standing in lines and holidays and fun doesn't make sense to an ant living an ant life. It's the same with us and a post-human being. Compared to them, we are ants. Running simulations for fun or science might be an absurdly stupid idea to them. But if they do want to run simulations for whatever reasons, and assumptions 1 to 3 are true too, then the chances are not zero that you are living inside a simulation. Assumption 5. If there are a lot of simulations, you are probably inside a simulation. If there are simulated civilizations, it's likely that there are a lot of them. After all, we assume that post-human beings have access to practically unlimited computing power. So if they run simulations, it would be convenient to run millions or even billions of them. If there are billions of simulated universes, there are probably trillions and trillions of simulated conscious beings, which would mean that the vast majority of all conscious beings that will ever have existed are simulated. So, for every conscious being made of flesh, a billion simulated ones exist.
Since we have no way of knowing if we are simulated or not, in this case, the chances of you being one of the 999,999,999 simulated ones are pretty high. So what you consider reality might not be real at all. You really might be simulated.
All of this is based on a lot of assumptions that we can't really test right now. So many scientists disagree with this whole thought experiment. So don't burn your house down to test if there will be glitches. If you are simulated, not that much changes for you. You might be on a small planet speeding through eternal nothingness, or a simulation inside a computer. Your existence does not become more or less scary and bizarre. All we can hope to do is try to live good lives and have a good time. And hope that if we actually are simulations in a supercomputer, nobody trips over the power cable.
Oh no. I think I just unplugged the simulation. But what if that doesn't matter? What if we are in one right now? What if you are simulated?
So we've already done a video on this, you know, idea of a simulation. So if you want to hear me talk about it, you know, far more extensively, go check out this Matrix video I made, where we talk about lots of crazy stuff.